By January of 1964, the police had chalked up a total of 11 murders. It would be almost another year and a half of investigating until March of 1965, to be exact, that a man would finally confess to 13 murders. But leading up to this confession, it was the manhunt of a lifetime. This was something that Phil was bred to do. There's no place in the city of Boston he didn't know, no person he couldn't talk to, no length he wouldn't go. In essence, Phil was made to work on this case, and his efforts show.
At what point were you involved in the case? How many killings have there been?
The very first killing, the murder, which was Ann Schlesler.
So you were in right from the very first killing, all the way through?
Yeah, right? The very first. And then when I moved to the Attorney General's office under the Strangling Bureau, and that was in late January of 1964, then I went to all the victims' apartments and viewed it and took notes and everything else.
But at no murder scene was there ever any physical evidence that gave the detectives a lead, although there did seem to be some common denominators.
One common denominator was nobody heard any rustling, banging, screaming in all 13 murders. Another common denominator, there was no sign of breaking or entering or any jimmy marks in the door. There was another common denominator was that we believed that he was a left-handed man. And why I said I say that is because I have here a photograph, one of the photographs. And as you can see, everything was thrown to the left, nothing on the right. This was done in many of the murder areas, everything to the left. And one of the murders on Park Drive in Boston Back Bay area is that the table in the kitchen where he said he had coffee, we noticed that the cup and the spoon was on the left-hand side.
So where does a detective even begin without the aid of DNA, forensics, and other modern science-based methods?
This is the thing that I'm most curious about. Where do you start? Okay, now you had nothing. You didn't have a fingerprint. You didn't have any witnesses. How do you start an investigation when you've got nothing to go on?
Well, on the first murder, we started with the interviewing everybody in the building, and we put all this information together, and then we start picking at it and going over and re-interviewing people, see if they forgot to say something to us, and this is how we do it.
This was Phil's MO. If there's one thing he could do, it was to talk to people, and that's what he did, door to door and for long hours.
We interviewed hundreds and hundreds of people throughout the murders in the Boston area. And we used to get phone calls that somebody would say, I think my boyfriend is the Strangler. At that time, he got the name as the Boston Strangler. Nobody knew what his real name was, but they just called it the Boston Strangler, the Phantom.
The Phantom.
Yeah, terrorizing the Boston area.
But the question I have to ask myself is, how much of an asset was the ability to talk to people? Nowadays, when I look at crime shows, forensics solve any crime, and if science can't, the detectives are always represented as having some uncanny ability or ESP. But back in the 1960s, Phil's style was good old-fashioned detective work. The analog nature of his files are a relic of a past world, but the depth is a craft that is hard to come by these days because of how steeped we are in digital technologies and reliant on them for processing. It wasn't so much about just talking with people, but how to get them to trust you and then digest that information. Phil wasn't doing Google searches. He wasn't using the maps on his smartphone to get around Boston or an Excel sheet to log info. This work wasn't glamorous, but his ability to put people at ease and let them talk was how he was able to have so many contacts, all of which were sources of information and were from all walks of life.
And you keep on going from door to door, knocking, and sometimes the door will slam in your face and sometimes it won't. They'll sit you down, give you coffee, and they'll talk all they want. And you don't interrupt them, you just let them ravel on and you take notes. And don't get excited if they say something, because all of a sudden they realize they say something that would hurt them in the future, or the Strangler would go after them because they're being interviewed by the police. So you just keep cool and calm and take your notes. Don't show any emotion that she said something that you didn't know. And that's the way we operate.
Phil could get anybody to put their guard down, and this was a huge asset. By letting people know they could trust him, he eventually received a tip that broke the case of the Boston Strangler. But why does no one know his story of how his detective work led him to the name of Albert DeSalvo?